Amen. Man, our God is worthy to be praised. Amen. We never could sing or say enough to praise and worship Him the way that we really do. Thank you, Paul, so much for staying faithful to the chore. I got a clip for you today, and I'm going to teach you some things today, and I hope that you will receive it as good, solid teaching, because I'm very excited about it. I always get excited about preaching, but teaching is my thing. I'm not a very good preacher. I don't do that very well, but I'm a pretty decent teacher, and I love to teach. I love to teach God's precepts, step on step, precept on precept, thought upon thought. I love that. That's where I'm in my best element. Now, I'm going to make it look like I'm preaching, but I'm really going to be teaching. Someone told me a long time ago, the only difference really is the T and the P. Some of you have to think about that. Anyway, you're spelling it out in your mind, right? Anyway, but I'm going to be teaching you under the confines of you think you're getting preached to. But I got a good clip to start it. It is an excellent clip because I'm going to be talking today about imitators, how that we mimic, we learn to imitate. This is a great clip. I can relate to it. It's when I saw it, I was amazed, okay? Are y'all ready for a great clip? Are you ready for something different here this morning? I'm just going to warn you, it's not churchy. It's not churchy, okay? But it's a great clip. You ready for a great clip? It involves a child. It'll be really good. All right? So watch this, and I'll be right back as we talk about imitators.
Welcome back to Little Big Shots, everybody. We're here with the 5-year-old Kung Fu expert from Japan. Please welcome Yusei.
Little Yusei is 5 years old. He watched that video of Bruce Lee, over and over and over for a period of a year till he could get every move down just right. And absolutely, it's phenomenal when you see the whole thing and you even the sounds that Bruce Lee used to make and how he did it. And I'm a martial artist from years gone by, and I could certainly relate to it. And those little bitty cat sounds, wah, it's good. I might do it when I preach a little bit. Wah. But anyway, you get the point. But here's the deal. He studied it for years. Every day he'd watch it and he'd do it, and he was about 4 years old. And he got it down pat. But let me just say, there's some things your kids watch and they don't have to study it a year and they get it down pat real quick. Real quick. And he studied it for a year. Imagine if a child has studied it for more than a year or a lifetime. When you can be as precise as this little five-year-old is, imagine how precise your children can be sometimes. But now, I've said all the negative that I'm going to say, and everybody say amen. Amen. I'm going to talk about the good. I'm going to talk about the positive. I'm going to talk about what we really need to talk about, honestly. And turn to your Bibles in Ephesians chapter number 5. Because I don't know if you know this, if you're not a regular Bible reader or studier, you may not even know that we're commanded in Scripture to be an imitator of God. And many people don't know that, or maybe you read it and you don't quite grasp what is being taught or what is being said here, and I want to try to help you just a little bit with that as we teach just a little bit. And then I'm going to give you, five things, but they're good. And they move along very quickly. But in Ephesians chapter number 5, it's important that we see what Paul is writing to the church at Ephesus, which was a great church. It was one of the most profound churches in all of his ministry, had great influence, and out of it many, many great saints came and many great church leaders came out of the church at Ephesus. And so when he writes, he's not writing in rebuke. He's not writing to try to counteract some false doctrine. He's writing to allow them to grow to more spiritual maturity because they're a very mature church in a very wicked city. And they do a lot of things really, really well. And he's writing because he loves them. He's encouraging them. He's telling them they've done well. He reminds them of their past, and he's telling them their future's bright. And he's just instructing them, and it's good. He's teaching them. I think a pastor must be apt to teach the way the Bible says, because that's what we're here for, to learn what God has for us. But in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, it's important. He says, therefore, and of course, I have to stop right there when it says therefore, because the rule of interpretation, the first thing you do when you go to Bible school and you get in hermeneutics and homiletics, okay, that means interpretation and expository teaching, or how to exposit the Word of God, they teach you a general rule. When you see a wherefore, therefore, you got to take into consideration what has been said. It's one of the ways you learn to study Scripture, how you understand your Bible. Whenever you see a wherefore or therefore, you go back and you take into account, because everything given prior to that sets up what this statement is going to make. Okay, because he's done all the introduction to get to the main point of what he's going to do. And in chapter 4, he talks about, and again, he tells us to walk in unity. It's important that we see that. It talks about spiritual gifts. It talks about the new man. It talks about how we're not to grieve the Holy Spirit. And in a moment, I'll go back and talk about some of those things. In chapter 4, it talks about how God himself teaches us. And by the time he gets to chapter 5, he ends chapter 4, verse 32. And just so that you know, in the original rendering, in the Greek text, if you looked at a Greek Bible today, it would not have chapter and verse. That has been put there so that you can understand the thought process and the idea process. In the original writing, this is a continuance of flow. Okay, so we would end it in chapter 4, verse 32, and it says, be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. But the thought process continues right on in chapter 5. Therefore, he says, therefore, and here's our text, be imitators of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ has also loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. Now, he's framed it all with chapter 4 with that ending statement, and then he tells us that we're to be an imitator of God. Now, it's important. And here's the first thing I want you to write down. He said it's a sweet-smelling aroma, and it's important that we understand this, because this is one of the things that all of us are affected by. Here's the first thing I want you to write down. Whether we will admit it or not, or even recognize it at all, we are all imitators. Okay? We are all imitators. We start out by imitating our parents. That's how we learn. Our parents teach us how to do certain things, some purposely and some non-purposely. Some things that we say and do, we don't mean to teach children by it, but in actuality, we do. Can I get an amen? Amen. So we imitate our parents. Things we promised we would never do and say to our children, we do. And we act just like our parents. I remember my kids telling me how that I needed to lighten up and be like other parents, and that sometimes we appeared too strict. How many of you have ever encountered that by your children? Yeah, amen. Dad, won't you be like everybody else? Let us do it. Nah, I'm just going to be mean. Nah. No. And the problem is that we knew better than they knew, okay? So, things we promised we would never do or say to our children, we do, and we act just like our parents because we learn from them. Now, here's my point. My kids are meaner than I was. Now, I use mean as that's not a real good term. They're more strict. They're more conscientious than we were. Because they knew even as strict as we were, they still did some things that violated our strict principles. So now they're stricter. So they make it harder for their kids to violate their principles. Amen? So then the grandkids run to us and we get to spoil them and we get to look like superheroes in their mind. But let me just say this, grandparents, you still are being imitated as young people look at you. And you're still influencing your children as your grandkids come to you. Your kids are watching how you're going to handle them. Are you going to violate their trust? So we're all imitators. It is a vicious cycle. And if you're a grandparent here today, we love to be on the good side of it. Can I get an amen from grandparents? Amen. We love the honor that it brings. We love the affection that it. We can pimp them all day long and we love it. We do. We love it. We love how they respond to us and want to come to our house and ride with us and sit with us and take all of our money. And they do. They do. So when it comes to our parents, we look like them. We act like them. We even talk like them. See, what you're saying to your children, they're going to emulate. What you allow them to see, they're going to emulate. Whether you think you're teaching them or not, they're watching. It's just naturally born into us that we imitate our parents. If you're working with your, we imitate our friends. We do. The clothes they wear. I heard somebody say today, they came in, they said, I got Natalie's leggings on. Somebody said, well, I like your leggings. So what? They're Natalie's leggings. That they must have got them from you or got the idea from you. Come here real quick. Just come here. Come here. No, come here. Come here, girlfriend. Come on. This is how we are. We want to imitate. Come here. Come on up. Give me some fashion walk. Come on. I wish I had the guys playing some music. Come on up. No, you got to come on up here. No. We like to emulate. Now, them are some wild-looking socks. What do you call those, leggings?
Yeah, leggings.
Leggings. Somebody else, Shirley, where's Shirley? You got leggings just like that, don't you? And when you walked in, you said, they're Natalie's leggings. I thought, well, you wearing Natalie's clothes? What's the deal? No. Did you mean that you're wearing something like she wears or something? Does she sell them? Oh, she sold them to you. Were they used?
No.
No? No. Did you like her leggings? Yeah, evidently. I've never seen Go Houston Day look quite like that. Never. No, I never have. But we like to imitate and emulate. Now, where are you going?
Stay right here.
Where are you going? I also heard that the music team, that the women on the team will call and say, we're going to wear black today, or we're going to wear purple or fuchsia. Or peacock. Yeah, we're going to wear peacock today. You told that to a dude, and the dude would look at you like I'm going to call my staff, and Ray, we're going to wear fuchsia next week, okay? Everybody wear fuchsia. But we do emulate, and we'll say, ooh, I like those boots. Some boots are bad to the bone. I like them boots. But those are the ugliest socks I've ever seen in my life.
They're not socks. They're leggings.
They're leggings. Well, I guess they're fashionable. They are so fashionable, they have influenced a good godly woman. They really have.
Yeah, but I got lots of room.
And if anybody wants to buy leggings, see Natalie, all right? Or ugly socks, see Natalie, all right? Give her a hand. We emulate the clothes they wear. They'll walk in and say, where'd you get that? Now, I'll be honest. Guys ask me where I get my shirts. They like my shirts. They like this two-tone thing that I do. It's just me. I like it. And they say, where'd you get it? And I say, Goodwill. And they say, oh, you're lying. I said, no, I'm not. I get them at Goodwill. Because, see, they're about 20 years in the past. Nobody has them in their closets anymore. They all take them to Goodwill. And instead of me paying $80, I pay $4.93. And on Wednesday, I get 25% off. So I pay about $3 for them. Which goodwill? I ain't telling you that, Jack. Ain't no way. No. But we do. We want to know. Where'd you get those boots? Where'd you get you? We want to imitate our friends, the clothes they wear, the cars or trucks they drive. Every time Dave gets a new truck, I ask him. And I try to be subtle. I do. I try to be subtle. Man, that's a good-looking truck. But what I'm really wanting to ask him, how much that thing cost, right? Yeah, and how we are? But and I want to know, do you have GPS? Do you have the leather? You got the Platinum Edition, I think. He always gets the high-dollar stuff, and I always have to get a step under. Anyway, y'all need to pray. Your pastor driving just all broke down. I talk about the... We like to look at what they drive, cars or trucks. Somebody has an Audi in here. Who's got an Audi? You don't have an Audi. No, you don't, Terry. Eliana has an Audi. You don't have an Audi. Don't raise your hand. That ain't your car. And she's going to buy it whether you say okay or not. She bought that Audi. I like her Audi. I do. But see, we look at people and we want to be like them. The values they live. Where are you going? Where are you guys going on vacation? Where are you going this weekend? What are you going to do? Da, da, da. I mean, that's just what we are. See, we imitate our heroes or people we admire. We are all imitators, so we need to be careful what we imitate. And here's the biggest question. When I said we imitate our heroes, define who your heroes really are. Define who your heroes really are. Because if you're going to be, and I think you agree, it is in us. We're born with it. Kids, watch what you do. And we grow up as children, and we have all of these heroes and things that we do. We have to define really who our heroes are. Second point, we need to be careful whom we choose to imitate. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm not good at rap music. And what do you call it? Let me put a frame on it. I don't like music where they teach kids to wear their pants down where you see crack there behind. And where they talk about killing cops. And we talk about women in a negative way. I don't like none of that junk. It should not be something that a Christian listens to, period. In the story, okay? But yet we find so many of our... I've always wanted to do it. I'm going to get the courage enough. I'm going to go to a McDonald's sometime and see somebody. And when they got their pants hanging, I'm just going to like. I'm going to jerk them down. You know what I'm talking about? You ever say, have you ever wanted to do it, Ray? Have you ever wanted to do it?
I just want to push them and run and see if they can catch up.
See if they can catch it. They can't catch it because their legs won't go only so far. They can't. And it is really an issue, too, if they wear it to church and God gets on their heart. And they and honestly, if this happens in our church and they come because they're going to bend to pray, I need a bunch of men doing golf around them so to cover them in prayer, all right? Some of you will get it, some of you won't, amen? But we got to be careful what we let our kids do, who their heroes are. See, our lives will become a reflection of whom we imitate. Your kids are going to watch you and they'll want to be like you. You should be the greatest hero in their life. That's why Paul in Ephesians 5:1 wrote, "Be imitators of God." The greatest influence in his life was God. And he had a bunch of great teachers and a bunch of people that had spoken into his life. And I won't take time to go into that. But he tells us, be an imitator of God. And there are few more discouraging experiences than trying to emulate the example of an expert when you barely qualify as an amateur. Let me give you an example. Don't you hate it when somebody tries to be something that they're not? Now honestly, I probably shouldn't reveal this to you. But I will. I really will. My daughter had a 12-year-old birthday party, I think, one time. It was a poodle skirt party. Isn't that right, Phyllis? We lived on Avenue and had a poodle skirt party, and Shannon had all of her friends and everything over. I just got to confess. And they wanted an Elvis imitation. And I had a white jumpsuit. With a big collar, you know what I mean? And they had their little party going on, all the little girls and doing their little poodle thing. And we moved all the furniture, and they were doing the stroll and all these good little deals. And at the end of the party, Elvis came down the stairs. And there was never a poorer example of someone trying to emulate someone than me trying to do him. And I say that we do silly things, but many of us try to be an expert when we're not even a good beginner. And we want to come on like we're a Bible teacher, or we got all the wisdom of God, and we're struggling ourselves in our own life. And there are few more discouraging experiences trying to emulate the example of an expert when you barely qualify as an amateur. If you ever see the video, you will understand I was absolutely worse than an amateur. It was horrible. So you say, if Paul tells us to be an imitator of God, how can we possibly imitate God? How can it seems almost impossible that we try to emulate God? Okay, let me give you something else to write down. The change that sounds impossible can happen via an imitator of God. Okay, now it's hard enough to grasp His greatness. Now God is great. Matter of fact, when we were a little bitty, God is great. God is good. Let us thank Him for our food. Right. How many have ever said that when you were a little bitty, learning to pray? God is great, God is good, let Him thank Him for our food. It's one thing. We learn about God's greatness. See, it's hard enough to grasp His greatness. He's glorious. I mean, He's glorious. He is all-sustaining. When we talk about great, that's not even a good word to talk about His greatness, because He goes beyond the comprehension of what we deem as great. He's more present in the positive than anything we can ever think of. His greatness, He's all wise. We think of that. We think of all of those things. He's self-sustaining. He doesn't need anything. He doesn't need us. He doesn't need what we do. Our praise doesn't affect Him. Our sin does not affect Him. Our influence does not affect Him. He is self-sustaining. All of circumstances of the world do not affect Him. He is glorious in everything that He does. And our whole motive is to bring Him glory, to make Him more glorious, because there's none bigger than Him. So the word great does not even describe Him, but the change that sounds impossible, be an imitator of God, is possible. Now listen, it's hard enough to grasp His greatness, but to comprehend His character. His character is flawless. I have a questionable character, and so do you. We're not always honest. God is always honest. His character is that He's an all-loving God, unconditionally loving. And you and I love based on condition. Somebody be mean to you, you're ready to knock them out. Say amen. Amen. You get angry. You get upset. You get all of those things. But the character of God, it's perfect love. He is absolutely holy. You can't even fathom the thought of Him being absolute holy. There is absolutely no sin, nothing evil, nothing dark about God. He is absolutely holy. He is light that illuminates the hearts of all people. Light, just He and of Himself, He is magnificent when we talk about His character and who He is. Perfect love, perfect holiness, He's undefiled. There is no evil in Him. So it's hard enough to grasp His greatness, to comprehend His character and His attributes. Omniscient, omnipresent, immutable. I could go on and on about the deep theological terms of what He is. He's all-powerful. He's all-knowing. He's ever-present. He never changes. I mean, when you think about His attributes, all-powerful, there's nothing more powerful in anything that we know that exists is powerful than God. He knows everything from past to present, not limited by time. He's eternal. He created everything. He had no beginning and no end. And He is, and of Himself, the most magnificent being that can ever be. It is so broad that we in humanity have difficulty understanding even who He is. It's very difficult. So now we offer degrees to mankind to get a degree in theology, the study of the theos, the study of God, because He's too big for us to understand. And in Him, we live, we breathe, and we move in Him, in this vastness of who He is. So it seems hard enough to grasp His greatness, comprehend His character, His attributes. They're beyond scope, even to measure, much less to be imitated. I guess I could try to imitate Him on the surface by doing external things. I could try. Paul tells us to be an imitator. I could try to be more loving. I could try to be more forgiving. I could try to be more encouraging. I could be more giving. But we find God is always giving, right? The very money that you have, God gave you. The very breath that you breathe, God allowed it. The very health that you have, God provides it. Everything. I could be a better listener. He hears everything that we say. That's one of my big faults. I'm not a real good listener. I'm a good talker, but I'm not a good listener. God always listens. He never sleeps. He never slumbers. He's never off duty. He's never on vacation. I could try doing some external things. I could try to have better relationships as God wants that perfect relationship with us. See, the problem is not so much on the outside, but being an imitator of God on the inside. That's the difficulty where I have. And my biggest challenge comes when I read Ephesians chapter 4 that set up the therefore. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 21 through 32. And again, I'm teaching you here because let's go back and read it. It's worth reading. This is really good. Because remember, we're trying to say, how is it possible to be an imitator of God who is so vast and beyond our comprehension? Amen. Are you still with me at this point? How is it possible? Because we're being taught, and again, a good church, you're a great church, and Paul writing to Ephesus, and I'm telling you, you do a lot of things incredibly well, and I'm so proud of you, and Paul was proud of this church, and everything he's writing is positive stuff. So, but my difficulty comes on how I imitate God when I go back to chapter 4, starting at maybe verse number 1. Let me go back and see where I want to start. Okay, let's start in chapter 4, verse 17. I'm sorry, chapter 4, verse 17. And Paul says this, "This I say therefore and testify in the Lord that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk in the futility of their mind." In other words, don't be thinking like the world. You've been saved, you've been redeemed, you're God's children, He's already laid that down, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart. Verse 19, "For who being past feeling have given themselves over to lewdness and to work all uncleanliness with greediness." Verse 21, "But you have not so learned Christ, if indeed you have heard Him and have been taught by Him, as the truth is in Jesus." Now the Him is a big H. That means being taught by God. God has taught you how you're to act through what Jesus did. God the Holy Spirit, say amen. You are being taught by God Himself how to act according to Jesus. Now watch. And He says this, "Taught by Him as the truth is in Jesus." Verse 22, "That you put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, that you have put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness." Now, he tells us, this is where I come, have difficulty with trying to be an imitator of God, that the old man always wants to show up when I want to do good. How many of you have trouble with that? So, but I've been taught by God, and I need to listen to God, and I need to put off the old man when the old man starts to show back up. Because the old man will show back up. He will. Most of us were living in the flesh long before we started living in the Spirit. And we live longer in the flesh than we have in the Spirit. Right? And we learned to emulate and imitate when we were very young some negative things, and those things still stick with us as the old man. But when I became the new man, behold, the old things have passed away, and behold, now all things become new. But it's still a learning process. I don't instantly forget about all of those old habits. I don't instantly forget about how sin felt. I don't instantly forget how certain things affected us. There is a process that goes on. But what we have done, we have killed the mindset of them. Our spirit truly wants to do better, but our flesh truly becomes weak, as Paul said. The things we want to do, we don't want to do. The things we don't want to do, we do. But he tells us to put it off because God is teaching us, okay? So that is where my challenge comes when I read that. So how does Paul expect us to really be imitators of a perfect, holy God? It almost seems like he's asking the impossible. If the old man always shows up, and if this old lifestyle constantly tries to come back before my face, it's not that I want to live it, but it still shows up. Every person in here will occasionally say a thing they wish they hadn't said, or do a thing they wish they'd never done, or read something they should have never read, or look at something they never should have looked at, or go to a place you never should have gone to, or hang out with people you never should have hung out with, because you know at the end of the day it's going to bring you grief. Amen? But we all do it. Can I get an amen? Now, if you're one of those who say, well, I never do it, I'm just pure, perfect, and holy. Yeah, but you're also lying. Amen? If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. I'd rather take a sinner who admits he's a sinner and falls short of the glory of God instead of that Pharisee who says, well, God, I'm glad I'm not like these other people. I want to be like the sinner who beats on his breast and says, God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner and I struggle every day. Because, see, that brings him glory. And he's glorious and he's perfect. So how in the world does Paul expect us to really be an imitator of a perfect, holy God? Let me give you the fourth thing. Our imitation of God starts with a realization that God loves us. He is your heavenly Father. You have been bought by the Spirit of adoption. You are part of God's family. And how many of all of you love your children? Say amen. Amen. Here's Paul's charge to us in chapter 3, verses 18 through 20. It's on the screen. He says that you may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and the length and the depth and the height, to know the love of Christ, which passes all understanding and knowledge, that you may be able to be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. We're going to read it again because I want it to sink in. The point he's making, our imitation of God starts with a realization that God loves us. Paul is telling this great church, I want you to be able to comprehend this important issue. Let's read it again. That you may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and the length and the depth and the height of God's love, to know the love of Christ, which passes understanding or knowledge, that you may be able to be filled with all the fullness of God, until you grasp the fact that God loves you. And he said, study it. Study the length, the breadth, the depth, the height. Study everything about God's love towards you. He said, when you do this, that you'll be able to comprehend it so that you can be filled with the fullness of God. Till you understand this, you'll never be filled with the fullness of God. You'll never be filled. And then he says in verse 20, now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. So we got to be able to comprehend how much God loves us. And we got to look at and see, you just can't say, well, Jesus died for my sins and that's it. God loves you a whole lot more than that. God loves you to the fact that he has put angels about you. He's given you the Holy Spirit. Everything about you is protected by God. He's prepared an eternal place for you. He's giving you his eternal word. His presence is ever with you, inside you. There's nothing about you that God doesn't love. I said about you. Your sin is not about you if you're a believer. Your sin is something that affects you, but that's not you. As Paul said, it's not me that sins, but the sin that is in me. In me, I'm full of the Holy Spirit. God lives in me. It's not me. It's the sin that I allow to come in. It's the sin that causes the problem. And God works in you. And until you know how much he loves you, you're never going to understand the fullness and the power of God's love in you. And you won't have the power of his life on you, because you'll always think, I've let him down. I've fallen short and I've done this and I've done that. And he says, but you got to know that he is able to do. Look at these superlative adjectives. And I'm not good in English, but I think I got that right. The superlative adjectives, to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask. You ask, he's going to beat what you ask. God, make me more holy. You can be as holy as you want to be. God, make me more perfect. You be as perfect as you want to be. God, help me get through this thing. You will. God, give me wisdom. Scripture says, if you lack wisdom, ask, and God gives it to you. How? Liberally, to all that ask. He's exceedingly abundantly able to do all that we ask. And maybe you're one of these weak people and say, well, I don't know if I can ask God. He's so busy creating the universe. But if you think it, he's able to do more than you think. Exceedingly abundantly able to do all that we ask or think according to the power that works in us. He's working in us. Our imitation of God starts with the realization that God loves us is important. See, when he offered himself up for the just, for the unjust, love obtained its climax and its maximum. When God offered himself up for us, love obtained its climax and its maximum. I'm going to take you to Romans chapter 5. This is really good. You can flip over if you want. If you just want to listen, just listen. Romans chapter 5, verse number 6. Check this out. For when we were still without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. Every ungodly, lost person in the world, and all ungodly were lost, Christ died for them all. For scarcely, verse 7, for a righteous man will one die. Yet perhaps for a good man, someone would even dare to die. I'll think about it if a good man. I might lay my life down on the line for the cause of a good man. But for the lost, for the unjust, for the ungodly. And then he says this. He says, for a good man, someone would even dare to die. Verse 8, but God demonstrated. Now that but is emphatically used. But God demonstrated his love. Hey, because you're all lost. You're all ungodly. You're all unjust. You're all not worthy. You all fall short of the glory of God. But God. Don't you like that? But God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath through him. See, when he offered himself up, the just for the unjust, love obtained its maximum and its climax. And Jesus even said this, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. So how can I imitate God? The highest form, the highest way that I can imitate God, because I can't be all-knowing. I can't be all-wise. I can't be as holy as he is. We've already declared that he is far beyond our comprehension. And no matter how well we tried, we can't create anything the way that he creates it. You can't speak something into being the way that he does. You don't have that attribute. So the task that Paul gives us, it seems impossible until we look at the phrase in chapter 5 where it says, therefore be imitators of God as dear children. And then in verse 2, and it says, and walk in love as Christ has also loved us and given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God. When love starts to be the preeminent thing that we're about, and it drives the way we think as he tells us to examine the length, the breadth, the depth, and the height of God's love. And when we're able to comprehend that, then we have all the power and all the fullness of God working in us. And because we have understood how much he loves us and what his love is all about, then he says that he is exceedingly able to do abundantly above all that we ask. So how can I imitate God? He offers himself up. And Jesus said, greater love hath no man than a man lay down his life for his friends. We have to love to the point. We have to love to the point that we're a difference maker. The amazingly large debt we could never pay was forgiven by God. So how dare us not to show love to every person that needs love? And you say, Pastor Mike, you're treading on dangerous ground. Who do we love? Everybody. And we're living in an age where everything is driven by political thought. Do we love the lesbian? According to Scripture, we do. Do we love the homosexual? According to Scripture, we do. Do we love the Muslim? According to Scripture, we do. Do we love our enemies? That's what Jesus said, amen. Love our enemies. Now, I know it's not politically correct because, see, we are even an imitator of the political party that we choose to follow. But there's something much greater than the political party that we choose to follow. And Paul said, be an imitator of God. Did he die for all the ungodly? Did he love all the ungodly? I just showed you in Scripture that he did. And the mandate for you to be an imitator of God is to use love as the climax or the maximum that we can do to be an imitator of God. We have to love the way that God did, and that is unconditional, and it is so hard. We can never pay that debt. We can't. But the amazingly large debt we could never pay was forgiven. And by the way, because ours was forgiven, how dare you hold back forgiveness from anybody? Because forgiveness is the greatest byproduct of love. It is the first cousin to love. You can't get away from it. It's part of the family of love. There's no way you can get away from it. It's in the bloodline of love. You have to learn to love to such a degree that you can, that forgiveness is almost automatic. It's almost automatic. It just comes. You say, well, they haven't asked me to forgive them yet. Do they really have to ask? While I was yet a sinner, Christ was sending His Son to die for me. Even before I was born, He sent His Son to die for me. Because He is an all-knowing God. And He knew I'd be born. And He knew I needed to be forgiven. And He knew I would be ungodly. And He knew I needed a way to have eternal life. And He provided it through His Son. He loved me even before I was born. And boy, if you've experienced God's love, then let me tell you, you're on the road to understanding. But He said you better examine the length, the breadth, the height, and the depth, and really meditate on it so that it does not block forgiveness, so that it does not make you bitter, so that it does not make you covet, so that it does not make... See, when you understand about the love of God, a lot of those other things take care of themselves. Did you know that? Scripture says love covers a multitude of sin. And many times we find that as our last resort when it should be our first resort. Well, let me move on to the fifth thing. Got to move pretty quick. It's 1 minute to 12. Write this down. Because we are loved by the Father and are forgiven by forgiven of our sins, we are to imitate Him by living a life of love and forgiveness. Let me read the text again. Therefore, be imitators of God as dear children. Walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given Himself for us. Given Himself for us. Given Himself for us, paid our debt. Romans 5 said, scarcely for a good man one would even think about dying, but we were all ungodly, and while we were at our very worst, God gave Himself for us. But yet, when our brothers and sisters stumble, fall, get in trouble, or our neighbor hacks us off because he just does something, we all of a sudden take a coarse attitude. Aren't you glad that God never takes a coarse attitude? And He said, all that come to me, I'll in no wise cast out. I don't know of any person that has ever come to God asking forgiveness and not received it. Any. I've never heard of a person said, I confessed it before God and He hadn't forgiven me. Every person that's ever come to God has been forgiven. If you've come to God today, you've been forgiven. You were forgiven before you were even born by God. His love is that vast. Now, does it affect our fellowship when we don't ask forgiveness? It certainly does, but that's not on God's part. That's on your part because He's unchangeable. Again, the greatness of God is too vast for us to be able to comprehend, so we have to use terms like anthropomorphisms and anthropopathisms, and we have to use big theological terms to try to narrow God down to where we can understand Him. We give God a form. All of a sudden, He's a spirit, and we say, Jesus seated at the right hand. God don't have a hand. But it's terms where we can understand. We couldn't understand the word love until God demonstrated this emotion of who He is. It's not a human term. It's a God term describing the very essence of the one who created it all. God is love. That's how He's described. And we think we invented the term. The term never needed to be invented because the term is God Himself. God is love. Love wasn't created. Love has always been there in the form of the Father. It's not a human term. It's a theological term describing the very nature of the one who is, and as we as His children should be an imitator of the one who is love and is all forgiving. Jesus said, all manner of sin shall be forgiven except one thing, rejection of the Holy Spirit. When the love of the Father is coming to you, revealing what Christ has done, you reject that. That's not forgiven as you reject what the love of the Father has done for you. But every other sin you'll ever commit is forgiven. Every other sin is forgiven. Now, man, that's some good stuff. And Paul tells us it's possible when you understand how much God loved you and you start to be an imitator of Him. The reason you understand it is so you can practice it with other people. In other words, the way that God loved you is how you should love other people. Walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given Himself for us. Ask yourself this question: who have I given myself for? Who have I given myself for? We're so easy to write people off. You're as guilty as I am. Say amen. Well, I'm just not going to talk to them anymore. I'm sorry. They just hacked me off. I'm done. I'm not going to talk to them anymore. You've shared Christ. You've shared the Scripture. You said this. I said that about my stepfather. I said, I'm not going to witness to him anymore. I'm sick of it. He's made me feel like a fool. He's rejected it. He's rejected it. He's rejected it. I am sick of it. He'll never change. How many have ever said something like that? Be honest. I'm sick of it. My little 7-year-old boy witnesses to him, tells him he needs to have Jesus in his heart or he's going to go to hell. Next Sunday, he goes to church. I'll never forget it. I don't know if it was on that Sunday or a following Sunday, but in the weeks to come, or it might have been that day, I don't know, and I don't want to misquote it, but he came because my son asked him to go, and he promised him he would, and he did. And before the service even started, he got saved as the pastor walked up to him, and right on the front row, off to the side, he knelt and accepted Christ as a Savior. Oh, you can clap. Yeah, it's great. But here's the point. I said, I'll never talk to him again about it. I'm done. You say, why did it happen that way? Because God knew that some 40 years or 30 years or 20 years, I don't remember the date, that I'd get up and I'd be teaching a bunch of other people, and I would be able to say, don't write people off, because with God, all things are possible. And it might not be you, but the seed that you plant. Don't ever give up on loving somebody or sharing the love of Jesus Christ. You say, my brother's wayward. He's just always going to live that way. Or my sister's this way. Or my cousin's this way. Understand, God knows everything that's going on. Are you going to be the vessel for positive influence? Are you going to be in on bringing him glory? Or are you going to say, I'm done? If you say you're done, you're going to feel like I did. You're going to feel ashamed. You're going to feel ashamed. You'll learn a lesson, but you'll feel ashamed, because with God, all things are possible. It's a good thing. Don't ever give up. And see, I said the fifth thing before I hadn't really got into it. I'm still talking about, who have you given yourself for? He said he gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling aroma. We think when we give ourselves over to the cause of Christ or to someone else that it's going to be a burden. You know what it is to God? The Scripture says it's a sweet smelling aroma when you give yourself and sacrifice for someone else to show the love of God. You know what God does? I'm going to do it the best way I know how. I love palmaria trees. Spring's fixing to be here. I love all the flowers. I love walking in greenhouses right now, because you can smell the flowers bloom in these greenhouses right now. And believe me, I'm sneaking and doing it. Phyllis is crazy, but I'm sneaking and buying plants and hiding them, and she'll see them in the spring somewhere. But I like to go in because it lifts my spirits. What are y'all laughing at me for? Look, there's a little coward in all of us, but she's wise. She said, where'd that one come from? You've been chopping again, hadn't you? But she loves them too. But I love the smell. And here's God. Every time you love someone to the point that you sacrifice for them, and by the way, let me say this for all the men. Men, love your wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it, a sweet-smelling aroma and a sacrifice. Here's God in heaven. I smell something. Not that. Oh, it's a sweet smell. Oh, that's Big Dave. I know that smell. He's doing something good again. I know that smell. That's a sweet aroma. I recognize that. Or, oh, that's Jim Birmingham. I know that. One of the most giving servants that I have. Oh, I know. That is Jim. He's sacrificially giving. Man, I love the smell of Jim giving sacrificially. Wow. And I could go on and on. That's the sweet smelling aroma that's described, that Paul writes about, when we give ourselves to someone else, imitating God, understanding how much He loves us. You understand what I'm saying? That's what it really says. Now, does God do that? I don't know, but He's able to identify each one of us, and He knows everything about us. Why would we be shocked that He doesn't even know what we do brings up a certain aroma for us in our lifestyle? The Bible says it keeps books on our thoughts, our talks, and our walks. Amen? So everything that we do, God knows. Giving an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. See, our forgiveness of wrongs is being as ungrudgingly as our Heavenly Father forgives of our wrongs. Our forgiveness of wrongs. Somebody wronged you? Yeah, it was wrong. If you got hurt, it was sorry that you got hurt or that you got wrong. How many have ever been wrong? Raise your hand. Hold them up high. Everybody in here has been wronged by somebody, right? Now, I didn't say put them down, put them back up. Now I want everybody to look around. You're not in some exclusive little group saying, well, I've been wrong and you just don't understand. Everybody in here, now you can put your hands down. Everybody in here understands you've been wrong. Everybody in here has been wrong. Okay? Our forgiving of wrongs is to be as ungrudgingly as our Heavenly Father forgives us of our wrongs. Yeah, you've been hurt? Forgive them anyway. Because God's forgiven you of all the people you hurt and all the ways you hurt Him. He's still loving you. He's never stopped loving you. He never will stop loving you. Read Romans 8. There's nothing that can separate you from the love of God. Isn't it amazing as we're to be imitators, but yet there's a lot of things that separate us from loving other people? Our dealings and interactions with others should be molded on the basis of God's dealing with us. Matthew 18, you're going to hate it. You are. You're going to hate this verse. Matthew 21:22. Then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall I forgive my brother who sins against me? And I forgive him. Lord, here's Peter. Peter's like me. How many of you guys would equate yourself with Peter being here? Say amen. Matter of fact, put your hands up. I want to see who you think you are. All the Peters stand up. That's even better. Let's go on public display. All the Peter personalities stand up. Now, you say, how do I know if I'm a Peter personality? That you put your foot in your mouth way too much. All right, these are the Peter personalities. Thank you, Tasha. I call you out. Yvette, you stand up, Yvette. Yvette, are you there? Come on, Yvette, stand up. You type A people. Peter was absolutely the example of a type A personality. Lord, I'll never forsake you. Lord, I'll never sin against you. Lord, I'll always be there. Yeah, okay. Now, I don't know why I told you to stand up, but I'm glad I did. Amen? No, here's the deal. He comes to him with his attitude. Lord, how often? No, I didn't tell y'all to sit down. Now you can sit down. Go ahead. No, Peter comes with this attitude. Lord, how often shall I forgive my brother? Just tell me. I want to check the box. Tell me, is it two times? Is it one time? Is it three times? Lord, just tell me, and when I get there, I'm going to check the box, and then I'm going to knock his full head off. That's what he's really saying. Who pulled the dagger in the garden to cut off Malchus's head? Peter. Nobody else but Peter. We know Jesus was there. He understood. But he whooped out the sword. And Jesus already told him, you live by the sword, you'll die by the sword. Put it up. So, man, Lord, how many times I got to forgive? I'm going to check the box. Give me a pencil. Three times? Two times? Maybe it's seven. God's perfect number. Look at how it reads. Then Peter came and said to him, Lord, how often shall I forgive my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times? Just seven? Why didn't Peter say 100 times? He didn't want to forgive him seven. Just seven times? Up seven times? Jesus said to him, I do not say to you up seven times. Do you see the little bit of rebuke? He's saying, you knucklehead. You've been with me 3.5 years. You're the protos, the preeminent disciple. You're the leader of this Mickey Mouse group? Really? You've been with me 3 years and you're asking me how many times you are supposed to forgive him? Seven? I'd have backhanded him. I would have. I'd have said, drop down, give me 10. Amen? That's what I'd have done. Jesus said, seven times? Jesus said to him, I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. You want to be a smart like a bat? You want to check the box? Get you a lot of ink there, buddy. That's modern day vernacular. Get you a pen with a lot of ink. You think seven? Try 470 times. Whatever. 490 times. That's somebody wanting to check the box. Yeah, check the box, check the box, check the box, check the box, check the box. In other words, what Jesus is saying, dude, you always forgive him. No matter how many times he sinned against you, you still forgive him. Why? Because your heavenly Father's forgiven you. Love and forgiveness is something every person can do, and we got to start today. See, Jesus told the Pharisees that the weightier matters of the law were mercy and forgiveness, that they'd done well in the tithe of the anise and the cumin. They'd done well of all the legalistic stuff, of keeping the smallest of the spices. They even count the mustard seeds out, and they tithe on. He said, you've done well. He said, but guess what? You've missed the weightier matters of the law. And many times we go through our Christian life, and we're encouraging, we do all this, but we miss the weightier matters of what it means, and that is to love and forgive. So that's why Paul tells us to be an imitator of God as dear children and walk in love. And make yourself be a sacrifice because it brings a sweet aroma to God. You cannot imitate God in the vastness and the greatness and the holiness and His nature of who He is, but you can, in practice the encompassed being of who He is, that I am His child. And I will eternally love people and forgive people, and I'll be a sweet aroma to God for doing that. And when I come into a relationship with a loving God, there'll be nothing between me and Him because I have practiced and I understand the fullness and the power that works in me. There'll be nothing between Him and me because I have practiced love and forgiveness, and He'll be working through me because love covers a multitude of sin. And if you need, Kenny, why don't you come? If you need this morning to ask God to forgive you of your attitude that maybe you haven't forgiven someone, maybe you haven't loved the way that you should love. This is not easy. It's not easy. Because it goes beyond the scope of our humanity. You have to allow the workings of God in you work its way out. If you just do it externally to check the box, you're as guilty as smart mouth Peter. And I say that with all reverence, but he was a smart mouth dude. He later gets it. But at this point in his Christian walk, he thought he had all the answers, and he didn't. Simple message. Love and forgiveness is the essence of the being of the one that we worship, because he is love. Love is not something that has been created. It is not a term that man has come up with. It is the very essence of the God that we serve. And when the Scripture defines Him, it simply says, God is love. Let's bring the lights down. How many of us have been guilty of not loving? The way that we should. Every one of us are guilty. How many of us have held back forgiveness because of our Pharisaical attitude, and we've never examined the length and the breadth and the depth and the height of the way that the Father loves us, and we've held it back? And we think that we're right, and we think that we're taking a religious stand, but in reality, what we're doing is not imitating our Heavenly Father, who constantly, constantly forgives and loves us. And put yourself in the place of the one that you're not loving and the one that you're withholding forgiveness for. When he goes before the throne, the Father is going to forgive them and love them, and nothing can separate them from God's love. So be that sweet sacrifice and that aroma to God this morning. I know we had an invitation, but I just think we ought to have a moment of meditation and an opportunity maybe for you to just say, God, you've opened my eyes here this morning. Or maybe you need to go to somebody. Let us all stand. We're brothers and sisters in Christ. We're of the same family in this place. How dare we be divided? Amen? And in this quiet moment, let the Lord have his way in your life. Some might want to come to the altar. Some might want to go put their arms around somebody and pray with them. And I don't know what the Lord would lead you to do, but I know I fall short. I know I do. And I have to ask the Lord to forgive me. I know I do. Maybe you do too. Let's pray. And as I pray, you do what you need to do. Don't wait till I'm done. Do it the moment I start praying. Father, we ask you right now to forgive us. Where we've not been that sweet sacrifice or that sweet aroma to someone else. We've not been that person to help in their great time of need. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would overpower us. That you will overpower us with our human thoughts, and that we would go beyond that, and that we would see the love that the Father has for us. I pray would not grieve you. As our heart is already telling us, yes, 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 but yet our mind will say, no, no, no. Father, I pray that we would do what the Holy Spirit tells us to do, that we not grieve him. Have your way at this moment. Forgive us where we have held back forgiveness and love for someone else. And let us be that sweet, sacrificial aroma to you, so that the power, the fullness of God can work in us. We know it can't work without love. Your word tells us that we are known as your disciples by the love we have for one another. I pray that it not be limited. In Jesus' name I pray and ask these things. Amen. And you might be at the altar. You take all the time you need. You might be standing. You say, what do I need to do? You might need to call somebody today and say, hey, man, I just want you to know I forgive you. You might need to write somebody a letter or send them a card. You might need to go to them and just tell them. You don't need to bring up what they did to hurt you. Just say, hey, I forgive you. And the Lord has spoken to my heart and he has forgiven you. Just whatever it is, do what God would have you to do. So you can be that sweet aroma. Of all the messages I've preached, I think in the last 5 or 6 months, to me, I'm just going to be honest with you, this is the most impactful message for believers in this body right now that you could ever hear. No big theological premise, no depthness of theological understanding, but simply saying we need to love people the way that God loves us and forgive them. The power that works in us allows us to do that. Would you agree with me? Don't you think it's been an incredibly powerful, eye-opening experience to understand how much God loves us and how much we're supposed to love somebody else? I pray that you do. I pray that it will affect your life. I pray that you'll put it into practice. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap offering if you would. God bless you. Just for a moment, be seated. I promised I would do this. Many of you don't know Charles and Melissa. Melissa plays a keyboard. Charles works back here. I mean, you know they're kids. You know they're part of our family. But Charles's mother, Miss Charlene, passed away this week. She's the lady that sat right over here. She'd be out in the front. Very sweet elderly lady. She was 80. And Thursday, she had some difficulty at home. They took her to the hospital. And she just unexpectedly went to be with the Lord. Didn't expect it at all. And she's resident of Vider, and they're going to be having the funeral there tomorrow. She loved coming here. She loves her family. Some good things that she had planned. Her funeral and all that has been taken care of. She was a good planner, but I know their heart is really, really grieved but yet excited that she won't suffer. She's in the place that the Lord has prepared for us. But if you see Charles a little bit down, encourage him. Where are you at, Charles? I know you're in here somewhere. He's right over there. Melissa's over there. Our hearts go out to you. I know many people have reached out, the music team, and we've called, and we've done all these things, and we've offered anything that we can do to help. We just want you to know that you're in our prayers. But we do rejoice that Miss Charlene's in heaven. And there is no more struggle with health. There is no more struggle with any of those things. The Lord just said it's time for you to come home and rest. That's the broad, bright side of life. See, death is nothing but the vehicle to get us to the best side of life. It's eternal life, right? She's in the good place. So our prayers go out to you guys. You need anything, let us know. If you see them down, I just wanted to let you know. You say, what's wrong with them? Well, when you lose your mama, that's tough. That's not easy. And it's not easy to lose a grandma. And I know the kids have been affected by it. But you've been a wonderful group to speak to today. Practice love. Practice forgiveness. You'll be better for it. And you'll be that sweet aroma that God loves you for. God bless you. You're dismissed. Amen.